Your attention, please.
The DisGeek Podcast.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the DisGeek Podcast. This is the podcast that's all about Disney theme parks, but mostly Disneyland. I'm your host, Daniel. Let me introduce you to the DisGeek crew. Let's say hello to Chris Allison. Chris.
Hey, guys.
So just so everyone knows, Chris might sound like a robot and cut in and out because we're having technical issues with Chris, but I'd rather have robot Chris than no Chris at all. Right, Chris?
Yes, sir.
Let's also say hello to Tommy Allison. What's up, Tommy?
Hey, good to be here.
And
ready to talk about Disney.
Yeah. And Jess Jones.
Hey, guys.
All right, hi. So we are back. Jess. We're going to talk more about Star Wars Galaxies Edge. Really exciting stuff. But we got some news to talk about first. There's a couple of stories that actually I just found out like 5 minutes ago. So I thought, why not? Breaking? Let's go ahead and breaking. Where's the noise? Capital letters, explanation points. Clickbait. Click here. Pixar Pals. That is the name of the new parking lot that is right next to Mickey and Friends. I have not seen this. The last time I was at Disneyland, they were sort of starting to clear the way for it. I have no idea what the area looks like. I saw like one picture and it looks pretty much the same as Mickey and Friends, I guess. I don't know. I don't know how they're directing traffic or any of that stuff, but they're calling it Pixar Land, Pixar Pals, which I don't know how I feel about that name. It's I don't know. I don't know. I feel like Disneyland should always stick to the Fab Five with the signage around our stuff. I don't know. I'm kind of old school that way, but whatever. Tommy, what do you think? We're old school.
We're definitely old school, but I thought that they would take advantage of the Cars movie and name it, you know, the Cars structure.
The Cars structure.
I mean, and then you name each level after a different car.
Yeah, Lightning McQueen.
Lightning McQueen, Mater.
Mater, Sally.
Yeah.
Red.
Exactly. I think they blew it on this one.
So, or maybe they're
and then you have the
get extra confusing because there's a Toy Story lot, but there's no Toy Story floor at the Pixar parking lot. But somebody's gonna be like, I parked in some Pixar movie.
Yeah, which one? Oh yeah, so yeah, exactly. Right.
Toy Story. Toy Story is this way. Oh wait, but I thought I was on the Dory section.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, when you think about it, you're absolutely right because people can be told, hey, listen, why am I going over to the Toy Story lot? I started at Pixar. It was at Pixar Pals. I'm confused.
Very true. Because, like, you know, tourists who go to Disneyland, that happens all the time. They take the tram to the wrong or the wrong bus or something. They take it to the wrong area. And I mean, I've done it.
I went once with someone that didn't know where they parked, and they were just like, oh, there was just some lampposts around. And so I took them to the Toy Story. It was completely wrong. I took them over to Mickey and Friends when Pinocchio lot was still a thing, and that was wrong. And it turns out of all the places they parked in Simba. So don't even begin to think that people will not know where. You know, don't even begin to think that people won't get confused.
Now, from a cast member point of view, Jess, the creation of this lot, once it's open and stuff, will that make life easier for you? Or are they still going to be taking you to sort of like where they park you now? Like, is that going to pretty much stay the same? Or does it give you guys a little bit more breathing room? Or is that just kind of yet to be determined?
Yeah, I mean, as far as I know, that extra parking structure is still going to just be guest parking. Occasionally, cast members park on Daisy of the current structure because there is a small lot right there on the the right side of the parking structure as you're driving into it. You can't see it. It's hidden. It's just one story. It's just a flat space where I used to park when I worked at WAD.
Yeah.
And then we would just take the actual guest shuttle into Downtown Disney. I thought it was weird when I first got hired, and then it only lasted a couple weeks, and then they were like, okay, now you have access to Simba, and then we parked over there. So, yeah, and occasionally I'd be able to park on that ball lot whenever I had a Disneyland shift, and you would just walk in that old gate, but now that Star Wars Land is getting built, I don't know how people get in and out of the park over there anymore, or if they even are allowed to now. It's been a long time since I've been able to walk that way, so I have no idea what's happening. Structures usually are just for guests. We don't hardly ever get to park in there. Like I said, occasionally they open up Daisy when Ball Lot is completely packed and they have a lot of people coming in that way. They will open that level up, and that's why all the bot dots are gone off of that level and all the speed bumps are gone off of that level if you ever do park in Daisy, which normally the guests do not get diverted into that area because it's almost always a cast lot, basically. That's what I call the AKA cast lot, is Daisy level.
No, that's interesting. What do you think of the name?
I was disappointed that they were calling it the Pixar Pals parking structure. I thought that they would just continue with the, you know, using some classic Disney characters, maybe bring back some of the characters that used to be in the parking lot of the old days where DCA is now. You know, like having those sections, like bring in like Eeyore back and Bambi and Kanga or something. I don't remember all of them. But
they could have called it Mickey and More Friends.
We should have a Pluto level. I'm just saying. So, I was just kind of disappointed. And I saw something real quick online about it today, but now I cannot find it. So I don't know if the information was wrong, so the person took it away, because it said that they were going to open late July for that parking structure. And I was like, well, how is that going to help with Star Wars Land? Isn't that the whole reason they're building the structure?
Right.
And then they also showed like the rundown of each level and what each level was going to be called. And then there were little, like, they're like little strange, like line drawings, like an icon for each film instead of like a character. So I think that's even going to be more confusing to people as to where they have parked. Because there's like just a simple, like, they're all like circles, with like a weird line, like icon in them. Like if just a fish is for the Nemo, you know, Finding Nemo level. And there's like a lightning bolt, I think, for the Cars level. And then the Incredibles is just the eye. So hopefully that's not all set in stone and they may change their minds on those things. Who knows?
I didn't notice that. Because yeah. I was looking, my eyes were looking at
the characters. You know,
I was thinking it's Incredibles, it's Mr. Incredible level, it's Coco level, it's Miguel, it's Mater and Lightning McQueen, it's Sully and Dory and whoever, these inside out people who I don't even know. I never watched the movie. I never saw it either.
Not
do you know any of the? These people who are joy and sadness.
Yep.
Joy, and sadness,
Bing
anger,
Bong, right?
Bing Bong.
I don't know. Where's
that's
the picture?
Who it is. Really small. They're really small too, but they'll probably be big enough so that I can read it. I have new glasses.
There you go.
But you're right. The little logos at the on the right hand side.
Yeah.
I'm on the eye level. I'm on the guitar level. This, you know. The lightning bolt level, the MI fish, and what's this for? Rainbow star? Would you call it? What would you?
That
call
looks
that?
Like maybe. A something straight out of like Mac. Like that's like a an icon for like the Photos app.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, just yeah. Like simple I'm on the Photos like, app. Like they're trying to look like their apps on your phone.
I'm serious. Like I'm looking right now at my Photos app on my iPhone, and it's almost identical.
You're right. It's like the camera app, right? Or the Photos app.
Oh, that's Bing Bong's flower.
It does look like it.
On his lapel.
That's very interesting. Very interesting observation, guys.
Yeah, it looks weird. Like something like Instagram could turn their icon into.
Apple's going to sue somebody soon.
Oh, yeah, right.
Take on Disney.
You know what? You know what? You know what they should have called this? It should have been called Pixar Pals Parking Plus.
Right.
Or Mickey Plus. There we go, right? Mickey's and Friends Plus. I parked at Mickey and Friends Plus.
That's the extra charge.
That would totally identify the thing and make it clear everything up.
You've got Mickey and Friends, which is, you know, your normal $20 to park, and then you got Pixar whatever plus.
Yeah, Pixar plus.
Or an extra.
Say that five times fast.
But just because. It's not like it's a better lot or anything. It's just because they're Disney and they can do it. That would be an interesting experiment. Just call it premium parking, add an extra $10, and just see what happens. Anyway.
They already do have premium parking if you want to park closer.
But don't make it any different. Just call it premium parking and see how many people, it's premium. Let's pay more. And then ask if there's a value later. You know what I'm saying?
I think a lot of these things, Disney does these things because a lot of people are not that. Well, I'm not saying that they're not that savvy, not that into Disney as much as we are, and so they're not aware of how Disney upcharges things or tries to sell them things that they really don't need, such as the premium parking and and how. Really make a big difference that you paid, you know, $15 more to go to walk an extra less than 15 feet than it possibly parked before.
Just be fair, Universal Hollywood does that too. They have premium parking.
Yeah.
So it happens. But I don't know. I was being snobby. Yeah,
remind me to ask me about Universal after the show.
Don't you dare mess with my home.
Uh-oh. I'm just fighting words.
I worked there that's my, like, I grew up there practically. All right, anyway, let's move on to rules. Disneyland has new rules. I literally just found out about this before the show started, but I see just sent us, looks very official, like infogram or whatever those things are called.
Infograph?
an infograph showing all the different rules, and it includes no smoking and strollers and stroller wagons and ice and dry ice. People bring dry ice into the park. Anyway, I think that's pretty cool. Beginning May 1st, all of the parks. This isn't just Disneyland, by the way. It's Walt Disney World as well.
Yeah, it says U.S. parks.
Our parks will become smoke-free. Designated smoking areas will be available outside of the parks. So that's over. Now, of course, nobody will actually follow the rule.
No. Nope, just as
they don't follow it now.
I'm enforcing this.
We already do.
I see it all. I remember every time I saw people smoking, and it's always funny to watch like the AP locals yell at other guests.
Oh, I catch people vaping on my ride.
That's amazing.
Trust me, it's not fun.
So that's May 1st. Also May 1st is strollers must be 31 inches wide and 52 inches long or smaller. And then it says many strollers.
No more double wide.
That's right. Many strollers meet these guidelines. It says that.
Be outlawed. They're the worst.
We always had a normal stroller. We had one that was long. I remember we had a long one one time, and it was so hard to push around that we stopped using it. And literally, it just became, we still, every once in a while we brought it, but the kids wouldn't really ride in it because it was impossible to steer. But it was great for like putting all our baby crap in it, you know, like all of our diapers and all that stuff. Like families who want to bring their little kids to Disneyland, these strollers are very helpful. But yeah, when they're like these giant things, it's a little much.
It's stupid.
And then the same.
You know, I'm glad that they've made an announcement about this, because I've been hit from behind many times.
Oh, yeah.
And run over by strollers. Just because parents are they're not watching where they are going, and they're on a mission to get to some ride or attraction and show or something like that. And so your shins and legs and feet are vulnerable to their actions. So, yeah, I'm glad that I think they should put like bumpers on those things.
I got hit in the back.
Can you imagine? It would be nice to have like some like bumpers or foam around them. At least, so like if somebody bumps you, at least you're not getting like a bruise the next day.
I got bumped and bruised by a lady in a wheelchair. The woman was pushing, and then when I turned around, the lady in the wheelchair was giving me lip. I looked down and she's just like, "Yeah, that's right." And I'm like, "Really?" And she's like, "Yeah, move faster." And I'm like, wow. And I said to her, and it was one of those times when like the fireworks just ended and everyone's moving. So it's not like I could move faster. There were people in front of me. We were in a crowd. So I said to her, "What am I supposed to do? There's people in front of me. I can't move faster." Really? And then I just moved aside. I go ahead, crush your way through people.
Yeah.
And then, of course, I look like the bad guy because I'm arguing with someone in a wheelchair.
Screw that.
Anyway, going on in this infographic, they also talk about, which is kind of like the same vein as strollers, is stroller wagons. You ever see these things where people...
Yeah, I mean, we weren't supposed to let those in for day like one.
It actually says, you're right, Jess, it actually says, as a reminder, wagons are not permitted in our parks. Beginning May 3rd. Like, I guess May 3rd, now we're cracking the whip.
You mean we can still bring in a wagon before May 3rd? I can bring in...
May 1st, excuse
some
me.
Hay and...
No, wagons have never been permitted, but then they started turning wagons into strollers, and apparently they were letting them in, and I was like, we're not supposed to let wagons in, whether they're covered or not. Like, these should not be here.
Those things are, like, massive.
They are. And those Kenzie ones are $500.
Yeah, they're expensive.
Oh, my God.
Wow. That's crazy.
Talk about a status symbol stroller.
Or not.
We used to have like the stroller that you get at Target, and then every once in a while we'd go to like the Beverly Center and there's people pushing around strollers over there that are like $300-$400 strollers, and we would just laugh at them. So this is what I recommend everyone should do. On
get an umbrella stroller. That's what
April 30th, bring your strollers, bring your ice, get out your cigarettes, and just walk around the park.
April 30th is going to have like a freaking riot.
Enjoy your last day.
It's just
going to
be cigarettes, wagons, and dry ice everywhere.
And then
everyone's ice cream is going to be hard as a rock. People are going to be dropping ice everywhere, slipping. Strollers, there's going to be so many strollers you can't walk down Main Street. And then they're just going to be blowing smoke in kids' faces in those giant square strollers.
Stroller revolt of 2019. And don't, the final rules, loose and dry ice are not permitted in the parks as of March 28th. Now, why is that a different date? I don't know why, but... It says usable.
They need to enforce it as soon as possible, apparently.
Reusable ice packs are recommended. So, why wouldn't you not bring one of those in the first place? These are for.
I know.
These are for the people who don't go normally.
What?
I'm going to dump it into Splash Mountain because the water is not cold enough. Like, what's the point?
Yeah, I wasn't sure about this. I made a comment on the post I found, and I got a few people that answered me. Do you guys want to hear what people said?
Sure. What did you say? You said, like, why would someone bring dry ice?
I said I'm happy for all of these new rules, but I don't understand the ice thing. And so I had someone said dry ice plus plastic bottle equals a bomb.
Yeah,
and I do remember when a cast member actually did that in one
of
the Toontown trash cans.
You're absolutely right. You're right.
That makes sense. And then they added regular ice in the cooler could be used to hide a weapon, I suppose.
Yeah, you can bury it. You can bury it underneath it. And they
And then someone else kind of said the same thing. It's harder to check the bottom of a cooler that has loose ice in it. That might have something to do with it.
Right. Exactly.
Could be a slip risk, too. If melting ice is dumped, there would be no hazard board. Disney would be liable, etc. And then also someone was thinking about the plants, saying, you know, the cold water could shock the plants and kill them and, you know, make the park not as beautiful. So
who brings ice? When was the last time you saw someone?
Who brings a real cooler that you can put ice in? I mean, nobody really carries that kind of thing around.
People who have insulin, and you have to keep insulin very cool. It's important. Yeah, so
if you guys do have those kind of medical things, you can always store your stuff at the first aid and baby center.
Exactly.
You don't have
but
to
I think I think right, yeah, exactly. And so but I mean to transport it from your car to the
ice packs,
of the park,
ice pack.
You know, exactly. I think so too. I could think of other reasons why, but I don't want to talk about it because I don't want to give anyone else any ideas. Bad ideas, yeah.
Yeah.
I have lots of these things that go on my mind that could be, you know.
Well, I was thinking like how kids like throw things at each other. So.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
That, but you could do that with your drink after you finish it. They put enough ice in it.
Exactly.
So I don't know. Whatever.
I don't think it's the ice per se, but what can be done with ice.
Yeah.
Per se.
And right.
I'll just leave it as that.
Sure.
Because, exactly. We'll just leave it right there.
Boom.
Boom. But, ice, no smoking. By the way, that no smoking rule, that whole thing, I don't know if you've seen the article on the Disney site about it. It was written by one of the people from the mom's blog. Disney didn't even have their own people write it. They had a mommy blogger write it for them. We just want to make you aware of some changes.
Did I tell you I looked into
Can
that?
Can you believe that? It would be, you know, somebody like Aaron Glover or somebody else like
right.
that. You know, or Sean Slater. But it's a mommy blogger that they have for the mom's blog. Telling us all about the new rules.
I looked into being a mommy blogger.
It's easier pill to swallow when it comes from a mom. I don't know.
Right, exactly.
You can't yell at a mom.
When they started diminishing the smoking areas, I said, you mark my words, one day this place is going to be smoke-free. I said, you better prepare or be done smoking by then. And she still smokes, and I told her it was coming, and I was right. It took them about 20 years, but they're doing it finally, and I'm very excited about it.
Yeah, where is Walt going to smoke now?
I was looking into being a mommy blogger. Men do it too, even though they call it mommy bloggers. And, you know, you go through a whole interview process. So I went through the whole thing, like looking at like the requirements and all this stuff. And I'm like, I'm a Disney podcast. So I know what I'm talking about. I thought I was eligible and everything. But then I found out like what they expect from you. Want you to do a lot of work for no pay.
Nothing.
That's right.
They give you the one thing they give you is a trip to either Disneyland or Walt Disney World for free, but like for like four people or something at max.
Go ahead. We lost you in the last half. Go ahead.
They'll give you a trip.
Oh, to like Walt Disney
World. To Disneyland for like, I believe it's a max of like four people. I think it might be more, but like, I just remember looking at it going like even if they picked me, like it wasn't worth my time.
No. And if you ever notice that the Disney mommy bloggers, there's always like, it's like 20 women and one guy.
I would have been the one guy.
Yeah, exactly. And so exactly. So that's kind of funny. And then the other thing is if you've ever read anything on the message boards about, it's time for the pick of the mommy bloggers. I mean, people are just so invested in it. And they're just like, there's like three or four rounds of interviews that Disney does.
Oh, yeah. It's crazy.
They cut people out, you know, and people are just like, I mean, they're
to work for free.
The emotional breakdowns over it. And there's long. I mean, long posts. And I had a friend that actually tried to do it, and she got down to the last round, and she didn't make it. And she could have done it. I thought she would have made it, but she didn't make it. And it's just it's interesting how it affects them so emotionally, how deeply. It's kind of like their identity is all wrapped up into it. It's just
I looked at it like it just would have been fun
about it.
Well, I was just saying I looked into it because I thought like, oh, that'd be kind of something fun.
Yeah,
you know. And
yeah, exactly. No, it's not. It's work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I do a lot of work on this show for free, so what difference
there is there? You go.
But I'm not getting a free trip out of it.
To do. You would be a PR hack.
We want to be nice to those PR hacks. I'm still trying to get in. I'm still trying to get a media ticket. It never happened. It's never going to happen. All right. Anyway, moving on to California Adventure. This went through me for a loop, too. This came out of nowhere. They're bringing in Mickey's PhilharMagic over to DCA, and they're putting it in the Sunshine Theater or whatever they call it. Where
Sunset Showcase.
There we go. I don't remember what it was called, and it was where Muppets used to be. What I don't get is why don't they bring the Muppets back instead of this?
Yeah, why would they?
I mean, I'm not a Muppet fan. I'm on record saying that.
I mean, I know Muppets aren't going to ever come back, so this is exciting to me.
I mean,
it's better than having previews in there all the time.
Yeah, no, for sure. For sure. No. I mean, it's cool. I mean, I saw that show a long time ago. I don't remember the last couple of times I went to Walt Disney World. I don't believe I went and saw it because I saw it, you know, so I don't remember. It was like Donald running around or something. But I thought it was interesting that they were bringing that over to California Adventure. So we knew that Muppets was gone, and it really is forever. There was always hope that it could come back, but nope. Mm. I think.
Well, I mean, I'm sure it's a real cheap version. I'm sure they didn't add the extra screens and the cool animatrons either.
Right.
But hey, we'll see, right? When it opens, one of us will see it, and we'll see what they did.
I mean, are they going to have that animatronic Donald butt at the end?
Who knows, right?
I mean, if they don't, I'll riot. Just...
Okay.
Where's my duck butt? That's you're gonna wear a t-shirt say where's my duck butt?
Is that your new hashtag?
Yeah. Where's my duck butt?
Where's my duck butt?
Yeah, hashtag.
My dog just brought me a dollar.
Nice.
A dollar?
Yeah. Came over to me and he dropped a dollar on my computer. I was like, thanks, buddy.
What are you fighting? Los Moody on the ground?
I don't know.
That's funny.
All right. So anyway, that's that. I want to move on to our main story. There's just a couple of news items that are related to Galaxy's Edge that I thought I'd just throw out there really quick. Star Wars, Galaxy's Edge, the hotels, Disneyland hotels are sold out for the opening of Galaxy's Edge. And I'm hearing
all three of them
the night before, all sold out. And they're saying that they're going to do no standby access initially during this when they're doing these reservations. So if you're not a hotel guest and you don't get a reservation, don't bother going because you're not going to get in. They flat out said that we're not going to do standby. And they also said, and I'm not sure how this is actually how they're going to do this, but they're going to be given a window of time that they can spend in Galaxy's Edge.
Yes. It's like a fast pass.
But so in the whole land, like, how are they going to kick people out of the land? I'm just curious how they would.
They'll probably have, like, a 4-hour or 3-hour time period, and then they'll have, like, 30 minutes to clear out the land, and they'll start kind of shoving people out, and then the next group will come in.
Yeah. That's insane. I mean,
that Millennium Falcon ride, we've already discussed that. That Millennium Falcon ride has incredible capacity. It has, like, Pirates-level capacity.
Yeah.
So, like, I don't see that being that much of an issue as long as they only let in a certain amount of people per day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or per hour. I mean, like, it's just simple math. They just have to kind of figure it out. That give everyone enough time to ride the ride, give everyone enough time to, and then, you know, enough time to get around the rest. It doesn't destroy your experience with the rest of the land, and then you get out for the next group.
I think I calculated that there are between California Adventure, excuse me, the Grand California Hotel, the Disneyland Hotel, and the Pixar Pier Hotel, there's just over 2,500 rooms. So if you figure, you know, like you said, you know, four people to a room, and that's 10,000 people right there.
Well, Millennium Park and Ride has a 28,800 maximum capacity for the day, 1,800 riders per hour. So how many people do you guys think could fit in Galaxy's Edge?
I wonder if they have to do this because of that kind of like fire code thing. Like there's only going to be so many people allowed in the area, kind of like when you're in a restaurant.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that was the issue with Cars Land, too. They were worried that
I mean,
there was
why we have to close the gates at the park, you know, all the time now anyway.
Yeah.
So I wonder if they're not counting it as like the rest of the park. It's just that one area has like a specific capacity law.
Yeah.
It could be because it's brand new. Everything else might be grandfathered in as a park as a whole. This area might not have had that privilege, and they have to do it this way. You never know. Sounds like that might be the case.
Huh.
With the way they're doing this, you know, this reservation thing.
Crazy times.
Yeah.
All right, why don't we go ahead and go to the main story?
And now we present our feature presentation on the DisGeek Podcast.
Welcome to this happy place. Welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world.
And we're back. So last time, last episode, we talked about Galaxy's Edge, and we went through the attractions. One of the things, though, that like I had this conspiracy theory about, you know, phase one and phase two and all this stuff. And we have since learned, I've heard that indeed the Rise of the Resistance is having some issues with the trackless system and all that stuff, and that is definitely why they're doing a phased opening. It seemed weird to me that both coasts are having the same problem with this ride, but apparently it's happening.
So, weird.
But I wanted to clarify that because I know I was just like, no, it's because of the crowds. Which, I don't know. Part of me still thinks that, but anyway. But I wanted to go through the rest of Galaxy's Edge. We talked a lot about the attractions and stuff, but there's a lot more to Galaxy's Edge than just Millennium Falcon and Rise of the Resistance. So I thought we'd go through, the different food stands and the different merchandise stores. I think the big, like, showcase, I guess, and I believe the first place is called Uga's Cantina. Does that sound right? Or Oga's Cantina?
Let's say Oga's.
Oga's, all right.
I thought it was Oga.
Oga, sounds all right. I'll Oga with that. Anyway, the proprietor is Oga Gara, and she makes sure to keep everyone in check in her establishment. So it's kind of like in the movies, you know? It's like it's the scum and villainy go into that place. And you're hanging out and you're having drinks, and stormtroopers are going to walk by every once in a while, and there's going to be smugglers in there. I wonder how long like this role playing will last, you know, like stormtroopers just kind of randomly walking around, and, you know, supposedly there's like this element of kind of like Westworld where there's actors all over the place and they're interacting with everybody. And I'm just curious how long that will last.
So So you mean how long will people be able to stay in character?
Yeah.
They'll be able to keep everyone to stay. You know, it's entertainment. So I think you're going to have to change it up every so often because people will get bored with it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, look at what's happened to Cars Land and, you know, they had the entertainment of, who is it? DJ? And
then right.
The little dance thing, and everyone was all upset. Oh, they're taking it away. There's nothing for the kids now. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. Lots of things, but it's still for the kids. I mean, you know, everything can't last forever. You know, they have to try different things. I think it's you need to always have a shot in the arm and do things a little bit differently. You have to take things away and then bring them back later on, you know? For nostalgia purposes.
Yeah, you don't know what you got till it's gone.
Yeah, exactly. I think that, you know, I think you're right. How long will it last? It may last. I mean, look at how long the Golden Horseshoe Review lasted with Wally Bogue. I mean, how many thousands and thousands of shows were done? And so, same thing with Billy Hill and the Hillbillies.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, you're right. There may be they may have to alter it, change it up, come with something new, but they probably will keep the same space.
I love the idea of it. I love the idea of the cantina, and it's the place where like kind of like the smugglers hang out, you know, and they're trying to avoid the authorities, but you know the First Order has to keep watch, and so they're gonna stormtroopers were gonna walk in every once in a while and just make sure everything's working out. I love the idea of all that. I also love the fact that the former pilot of Star Tours, RX-24, Paul Rubens, the man himself, will be the DJ and will spinning tunes. Oh my god, that's so amazing! I just want the soundtrack. I just want the soundtrack now. I just want to hear this loop.
I think. One of the writers that one of the people that were able to go to the preview found out that there's like a 3-hour loop of this.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's like stupid long.
It's really long, so
that's good. Disney that's usually only does like an hour loop and
right. Yeah, there's lots of things. Yeah.
3 hours would be great for the cast members working there.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know what I was thinking, Daniel, about this type of experience inside the bar is that remember when they had the Frontierland experience?
Yes,
I was thinking like, yeah, you had to go from one place to another, and you got, you know, the little wooden coins, and you got the.
Think that was the beta test for this.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think that we're gonna have some sort of things where you can, you know, you'll get some kind of shekel or some kind of card or some kind of. You know, somebody will see, you know, it'd be kind of interesting if somebody comes up to you and, you know, on the sly hands you
that you're wanted,
paperwork.
You
yeah, watch yourself, you know. I saw this. Is this you? And can you imagine? They take a picture of you surreptitiously, and then they go, hey, the stormtroopers were passing this around. This looks like you. Is it? And then you look at it, and it is you.
Oh, my God.
Oh, wouldn't that be totally freaky? You know?
And it's then security, sudden, Disney security.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, wouldn't it be kind of fun?
That's beyond Facebook now.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, you know, think about it. They're doing it kind of with this in Star Tours with, you know, the Rebel spy is here, you know? And, you know, you're picked out, randomly picked out. I mean, why wouldn't they try to do something like that in the bar, you know, and just kind of like. And then it'd be kind of funny if you're like followed around and all of a sudden, you know, hey, over there, you'll hear over your shoulder, hey, there he is. There's the guy.
They're going to have like Uga's Cantina website. And they'll say, have you seen this person that they posted on the web and it's you and that's not your wife?
Yeah, exactly. Or you walk by a screen and all of a sudden you see yourself on the screen wanted. You know, it'd be pretty wild.
You're like I don't drink anymore, and there's a picture of you holding a carbon freeze. Yeah, they have some amazing looking drinks as well. If you go to our website, I have a story on all of the details for Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, and I got a bunch of pictures of the drinks, and I've labeled them so you know which drink is which. And some of the names are just awesome. Carbon Freeze, Uga's Obsession, Cliff Dweller. This one is my favorite. There's one, I think these are non-alcoholic. I'm not 100% sure. But there's one that looks like it has like a donut on top of it.
Yeah.
See that? Is that the one on the back?
The blue milk. The Blue Bantha. That's different than the blue milk. They have Mugan tea. Okay, tea with lime. But they have this Blue Bantha, and there's like a donut on top of it. And then they have this thing called a Bloody Rancor, and there's a Those bone on top of it. Right, yeah, I think they're out non-alcoholic, maybe. I don't know.
This picture, these are alcohol drinks.
Oh, okay.
Mugen tea is probably like a...
Long Island iced tea.
Yeah. This other one...
Well, I see those Gourmet Luxardo cherries, so it's got to be some kind of a tiki drink.
Right, exactly. There's like an orange on the Blue Bantha sitting on top of an orange peel. Something. It looks like a granola with...
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, you're... Okay. It looked like a donut to me.
If you look a little closer, it's not... I don't think it's a donut.
You're
I think
right.
It's some kind of granola with, like, icing of some sort. But, I mean, it could be a cookie or it could be... to me, it looks like orange peel. Now, I could be wrong. It could be, like, a cookie or something like that. Kind of looks like a... Maybe it's a Bantha turd or something like that.
I like the way you think, Dad. Bantha turd.
Does kind of look like that, to be fair. I mean,
no, I mean, it does. I mean, it's kind of like, yeah, the way it's kind of swirling,
what's this drink with the dog
around, you know? What?
What's that drink with the dog bone on it?
Yeah, I don't know. But
that's the Bloody Rancor.
Like out of a
I mean, that's what that looks like. It looks like a dog biscuit.
It does look like a milk bone.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. And then there's a couple down here also. The Outer Rim, the Bespin Fizz, the Yub Nub. I gotta love that name.
Yub
and the
Nub.
Fuzzy Tauntaun.
Okay. Yep. Isn't Yub Nub the thing that the...
The Ewoks
say,
yeah,
right.
Yep, no.
They sing
the song.
Yub Nub,
yep.
Right?
For all you youngins out there,
you'll be singing that song after about three of those drinks, right?
Right. Before Return of the Jedi, the old version before George Lucas did the special edition, the end of the film had a song called Yub Nub, but when they did the special edition, they got rid of that song. So for all you young people out there, look up, maybe it's on YouTube, but look up the old original ending. And it's this amazing Ewok song called Yub Nub.
Now the Outer Rim, have you take a look at that Outer Rim? That thing that's sitting on the edge of the rim. That doesn't look too good. I mean, that looks like a little bit of baby poop right there.
No.
If you're asking me, that yellow stuff. It does. It really does. I'm just calling it what it is.
I'm sure if I looked it up somewhere, really I'd know what's in these drinks. I don't know what's in these drinks. I'm just looking at the photos. But
very good. Is the fuzzy taunt with that fuzz on the top? That looks actually pretty good.
All these drinks look good.
They all look great. I can't wait to go and try the whole menu.
It all looks delicious. I'll try it all.
Fizz. Now, are these... Oh, the Bespin Fizz is probably like the CO2. They put the CO2 stuff in it, you know, make it real cold.
This is the part... You'll order the drink. You'll stand in line for 30 minutes to get your drink. You'll get your drink, and then they'll kick you out of the bar and then say, sorry, no alcoholic drinks allowed outside of Galaxy's Edge. That's opening day. All right, let's go on to the next place.
They'll probably have all these drinks like pre-made. You know, hours beforehand, and just like, oh, here you go. And just take your money, take your money. That's probably
I forgot what it was called, but the drink that they have at, Pandora at Animal Kingdom, and it has like little boba balls in it. It was a drink though. I forgot what it was called, but it was really good. Really good. That's what these drinks remind me of, some of the drinks that they did at Avatar. Right. Let's go to the next restaurant. It's called Docking Bay 7 Food and Cargo. And so this is going to be casual, fast casual eatery. And this is the building, like, if you've seen all of the concept art and the models and all this stuff, and there's this building with a shuttle on top of it, that's Docking Bay 7. And they, as well, also have some amazing-looking food here. And they have, you know, I love how every location has a story with it.
Yeah.
And so, like, there's a guy who runs it and is... Strono Cookie Tugs. He's the guy who runs the place, and it says that he once cooked for Maz Kanata. That's from Force Awakens.
Maz is the one, the
glasses,
the big glasses,
And so they have like a bunch of dishes here. So like they have. The Ronto Roasters, which is, I'm sorry, that's actually another location. The food is actually, like, they have some fish, oven roasted burra fish. I'm assuming these are fake names. I'm not a fish expert, but I don't think that's a real fish in the earth.
No, it looks like Mexican food.
Yeah,
I mean this Lucian garden spread. Looks like beef with salsa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're right. Yeah.
It does, doesn't it?
No, I mean, for sure.
With pita bread.
Pico de gallo.
Yeah, pico de gallo. Pico. Yeah, the other one is the fish. Yeah.
Probably looks like a Mediterranean dish.
Yeah, exactly. Mediterranean dish.
Explain this next one.
Yeah. And then the other one is the yip. That looks like
fried Andorian tip yip.
Yeah,
it looks
like sweet potato.
Oh, okay.
That looks like a vegan.
It might be a vegetarian dish.
Right? Yeah. Like a vegan.
It's probably deep fried tofu or something.
To me, it looks like a deep fried sweet potato with rice and peas and carrots.
Or maybe it's a huge chunk of zucchini.
Yeah.
Maybe it's like a zucchini patty or something.
You know what's kind of interesting is that you notice like all the dishware is all dark and black and kind of rustic and things
it's
like
cool
that.
Looking.
It's kind of, yeah.
Hey,
and look at the, I don't know if you can see like on the Volusian.
Can you see the screen?
Volusian? What
does
the Volusian garden spread? I don't know. Hey, do you guys see the Volusian garden spread?
Yeah.
Okay, so look down to the
pork
lower right hand corner and you'll see like a fork and a spoon.
It's a spork.
It's a spoon. Spork.
A spork.
Right? Spork.
There you go. Oh,
wait.
It was
Wait. Wait.
Huh?
You guys.
What?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
As I say, I think I see something that they're just not gonna. They're not gonna sell. They'll probably take out.
What?
Go down to the Thatcher and move juice.
Yes.
Down at the bottom.
That's like way too dangerous. Look at all that ice.
Oh my gosh! You're right.
Oh my gosh.
I didn't want to say anything.
That looks totally dangerous.
I don't think they're going to sell that. I mean, Galaxy's Edge opens after May 1st, right?
Just think what people would do with that ice. They might, like,
way too dangerous.
They're good looking drinks, though.
I know. It looks delicious.
And then underneath that, we have a couple of desserts, the raspberry cream puff and chocolate cake. And I'm disappointed they couldn't come up with a clever name for those.
I'll eat both of them.
Absolutely.
100%.
Raspberry cream puff and chocolate cake. Let's think of a names for it. Let's see.
Tauntaun.
I don't know. This green stuff that's kind of like coming off of it doesn't look too appetizing. But
how about Dagobah Delicate?
Dagobah
Delicacies.
Dagobah.
Is that like the Donald butt?
Eat these, you will.
Exactly. Ooh, some kettle
it
corn.
Kinda like, you know, it kind of looks like these things have moss on them.
It does. That's right? why I was thinking of Dagobah, you know.
Okay.
Okay, anyway.
I'm not following you on that one, but...
Dagobah's in the swamps and the jungle and stuff.
Oh. correct.
That's yoga. That's Yoda's planet.
Episode five, excuse me.
Yeah.
I'm still. Episode two. See, I said it right off the first. See, I'm old school. Episode two.
Yeah, that's right.
Now it's episode five. See the little round circle?
Oh, on the dessert, pieces? Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, I think, isn't that supposed to be Black Spire?
Yeah.
Is that what it is? Is that what it is, Jess?
That's pretty dope.
Black Spire.
I don't know. Okay.
I do see just something on there.
Yeah,
it's got a little logo on it.
I like the dishware. Like I said, I think the dishware.
I love these plates. These are amazing.
Yeah, it's kind of nice. Kind of looks like something, you know.
Galaxy looking.
Yeah, it looks Star Wars-y. Yeah, cool.
So the next place is Ronto Roosters. Roasters, sorry.
this looks like pretty wild. This looks really cool. Anything with fire is pretty cool.
Yeah.
You know, right? I mean.
And all that.
Is probably like a quick service place, right?
Yeah. All of that is to serve tacos.
Sausage, grilled sausage, roasted pork, and turkey jerky, and how do you say this? Mealio rub? Juice?
Mealio rub?
I don't know.
Something like that.
You know what? They need to have like tri-tip or, you know, brisket in here too.
Can I have the red juice, please?
Yeah.
Nobody like, can freaking pronounce that.
No ice though.
Yeah. Oh, Mealio.
Mealio.
With ice. It has ice. Loose ice in it.
Look at all that ice. Oh my god.
Yeah. It's too dangerous. Okay, and even worse, the green and blue milk is made of ice.
Okay, so the turkey jerky and Ronto wrap. These are pita bread. These look like hot dog pitas.
Yeah, they look good.
With coleslaw on top of it.
I'll try it. All right.
Look, people,
like
we're
food and wine.
This is like a mashup of all food. It's kind of like we're gonna ruin everything. We're gonna take your hot dog and we're gonna stick it in a tortilla. right, this is like how you ruin kids, you know.
Look, people, we're not a food blog, okay? We're just throwing it out there, like we're just commenting on what we see.
I don't know, it just seems kind of weird, but hey, you know, people like to try different flavors and things like that. Let's mix up our food. I like the idea of a roaster, a fire pit to go get your food.
Yeah, that's super.
That place looks.
I mean, it's a concept drawing, but hopefully it looks like this.
The concept kind of reminds me of Bengal barbecue, but fancier.
Yeah.
You know, exactly. You know what would be awesome is that all of a sudden somebody comes out back and they drag a tauntaun over there and they start cutting up on the floor and throwing it under the fire. That'd be awesome. Has skin it right there. The blood's kind of going all over the place. And then, you know.
And then you can, like, get into it.
Huh?
And then you can jump inside of it.
Oh, exactly. I want to eat it. I want them to roast it and eat it in front of me. I want them to cut it up and roast it, and I'll eat it right in front of me. Yeah.
Just make sure there's no Luke Skywalker inside, or, you know.
Yeah, well, we will make sure like that. But see, it's like that roaster is like a jet engine of some sort.
Yeah.
You look at it, it looks like
Yeah,
it,
oh, yeah, that's what
You
it
know
is.
What?
If you look at it, is, you know, and it's like sending the heat all the way down into
I didn't realize that was food. I thought that was like a table ornament or something. That's the turkey jerky.
Like a roasting. This is like a roasting area, the barbecue.
Yeah.
And so they're using a jet engine to barbecue your food.
Right.
Yeah.
But like if you look between the tacos.
Maybe I mean not a jet engine, spaceship engine. That's
right.
Well, not real. It's a pod racing engine.
That's what it is. You're right. That's what it is.
That's what we call pod racing.
What they said it was.
You're right. That's what exactly. You're right.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah. Oh, there it is. Oh, it is. An old pod racing engine. That's it.
That is dope.
Isn't that cool? That's an awesome idea. Whoever came up with that should get extra money.
Probably won't.
Thank you, Dad. For your wonderful, positive outlook on life. All right, let's skip to the cool part, the toys.
No, we didn't talk about blue milk and green milk.
I think it's fine. They're going to have blue milk and green milk, and guess what? They're also selling popcorn. Just like Cars Land.
Isn't it like the blue milk and green milk kind of like really kind of, let's be honest, guys. It's really kind of like really small, loose ice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a little dangerous, but.
It's not milk, okay. Despite the name.
It's supposed frosty. To be like a milkshake, right?
No, it's supposed to be like a frosty type of thing.
Yeah.
It's not. It's kind of interesting.
Well, it says here that it's similar to a milkshake. And that it's similar to a milkshake. That's what they're saying. According to Entertainment Weekly.
It's interesting that Scott Trowbridge actually says, it's not actually milk.
Mr. Universal over here.
Exactly. It'll be soft frozen, similar to a milkshake, while the green milk will fit you a more citrusy flavors. Okay.
And then, like Chris said, popcorn. Cat, yep. Sack is cattle. Kettle.
Kettle corn.
Sack is cattle.
I have a hard time saying all this stuff even 10 years from now, I'm sure.
Daniel, I want to go to Galaxy's Edge with you, and I just want you to order everything for me.
Right.
Please.
And try to say it.
I want you to order for me.
It'll be a challenge.
That'd be a great episode.
I think so. I think you're right. I'd take the quarter. We go, okay, this episode, I'm going to go and try to order food at Star Wars. All right, toys, merchandise, merch. Beena's Creature Stall. That's one of the places.
All right, they sell porgs, which is super cool. And there's going to be aquariums in the store and cages with live animals in them.
That's awesome.
Hey.
What?
They should have sold porgs for food.
Yeah,
remember Chewbacca grabbing a porg and cooking it roasting?
Pork on the stick, yeah.
Yeah.
Why isn't that an item? That should be. You're so right.
You're right. Maybe. Wouldn't it be awesome?
Like a turkey.
Chewie would be there.
Pork.
Handing them out.
What's that thing on the bottom? It looks like Perry the Platypus.
It does. Right. Not.
If it was blue, that's Perry the Platypus.
Well, you know what I want to know is what is the thing in the upper left-hand corner, though? It looks like an eye from, like, looks like one of Rick Griffin's artwork.
Right. That's the Raftar from episode 7.
That's right.
It's what?
Those things are giant.
Raftar from episode 7. That giant thing that Han Solo caught?
Oh, you're right. That's right. Inside the ship.
Yeah, that ate all those people.
That ate all the people. Yeah, exactly. What was it called again?
Raftar,
okay.
Yeah. So it's all a bunch of plush toys. I love the Tauntaun. It's super cute. I wish you could open it up and the guts come out.
Crawl inside.
You know what? You'll probably actually be able to do that.
I hope so.
Head pops out and say, this spot's taken.
I wonder if these droids... there's also a droid shop.
Yeah.
Mubo's Depot. I wonder if with these droids you could... They're going to be like... radio controlled or anything like that.
It says they're not small like at the Droid Factory or whatever that's called in Tomorrowland.
They look like popcorn buckets.
They're decent size. It says they're about the size of a toaster.
So the
Rex one is a Bluetooth speaker. So that will be amazing.
Here's what I'm wondering. How are they going to be able to prevent people from taking them out and running them all over Disneyland and not running over people? We're going to get rid of strollers. Now we're going to have droids running through the parks.
I get the feeling they're going to be like put in a special box.
I think that's so too. I think they're going to say, you know what? We'll hold on to this till the end of the day. You can pick up your droid at guest services at the stroller place. You know, where you go pick up your stuff now.
That certainly wouldn't be a problem later in the day.
Yeah. How much do you think you're going to be paying for a droid?
Oh, they don't.
$150.
Yeah.
How much?
$150 probably.
Minimum $100.
Yeah.
Have you guys ever looked at online? I mean, you know, there's like droid building groups things like that. Yeah, it's a big deal. Building a droid is a big deal. I mean, people spend thousands of dollars doing these things. So they're going to be mass producing these things. I'm just thinking
these. You build your own.
But these. So you think these are just stationary type of things? These are not something that can travel around your house or on the sidewalk or anything like that.
I mean, they look like popcorn buckets to me.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah, it's kind of hard to figure out the size of these.
And it doesn't say that they're like.
You say the size of a toaster, but large scale droids will cruise around the shop while you create your new friend. So you are creating one, and so I don't know.
They're just plastic pieces you're gonna snap together.
So this is kind of like the droid building that they already have over outside scale. Of Star Tours.
Correct.
But it's gonna be bigger.
Yeah, because I don't think they're actual.
I thought this was gonna be actual droids that you actually. Are remote control, that sort of thing.
I was just wondering that. I wasn't making a statement that they were.
Okay. I was just trying to clarify things.
But yeah. I wanted to go... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I think it would say if they were actual, like, remote control units.
Right, exactly.
And okay. I think, like, if they were that complicated, you wouldn't be, like, snapping the parts together yourself and building it yourself.
I don't know.
My assumption. I don't know, though. It doesn't really give you that much information.
I don't know about you guys, but at the Toydarian toy shop, go down real quick. Look at that Watto.
That's amazing.
I want that Watto. I need that Watto. I need it. It's so adorable. It would go well with my Splatoon little plushie I have on my shelf over here.
Where's Watto?
Up on the upper left.
Oh, underneath, right beside Yoda?
Yeah.
I believe his race is the Toydarian. I think this is a play on names.
Oh, I see Watto now. Okay. In the blue. I'm sorry.
It's because the shop is run by Zabeka, the Toydarian.
Yeah.
Well, they have an animate. No, they won't.
You don't know.
No, I don't. I mean,
they're throwing lots of money into this crap.
Dude. Yeah.
I mean, they have a pod racer grill.
That's very cool. And then I think, the coolest shop that's probably going to be there is the Build Your Own Lightsaber, which I believe is at a place called Doc Ondar's Den of Antiquities. $100. Yeah. They're selling all kinds of cool stuff that are like artifacts from the Jedi, artifacts from the Sith. They're going to have... holocrons.
Will they have the Jedi? What is it? Their Bibles and things like that.
Maybe.
Yeah, you can buy a Bible.
The Jedi, the Jedi scrolls or whatever, and you can get them, and then you can burn them up like Yoda.
Does he's planning on starting a new religion? That's just how they're going to start making their new money.
Yeah, exactly.
Going to start selling Bibles.
Jedi archive. Oh, the Jedi scrolls. Yeah. The scrolls.
Anyway, and so this is the store that's going
to
have
historic lightsabers for Earthlings to take home and to remember our intergalactic journey.
Oh, wait, does that mean Earth actually exists in the Star Wars universe? That hasn't been confirmed yet.
Yeah. Holocron cubes.
I don't know why they're selling those. What's the point?
I don't know.
It's the cube.
Because collectors, man.
Just a bunch of symbols on it, right?
But I believe this is the store that's going to have sort of the like Harry Potter wand thing going on, where there's going to be a little show, and there's going to be characters, and you could build your lightsaber, and they're going to make like a big stink out of it, and then they'll give the bill to the parents.
$150 for a complete lightsaber, that's the starting price.
Starting around.
That's probably the base.
$250 with all the accessories.
Yeah.
And then you got.
Oh, you want it to glow?
Yeah.
Oh, you want it to, extract or whatever? I think the lightsabers, they're like the lightsabers that, like, I don't know if you've ever seen, like, at Comic-Con or any of these conventions. They have these lightsabers that they sell and they glow. They're like, and they're these sticks. They're like these plastic sticks. They're not like. The lightsabers you see like at the toy store and you flip them and then they're like these plastic green cones that come out or whatever.
Right,
These are like high end with a light inside and it makes the noise when you push the button. I used to have one that I got for Christmas one time, and they're really neat, and they sell all kinds. Like, I've gone to like WonderCon, which I believe is happening this weekend actually, but I've gone to WonderCon, and there's like one of the vendors there sells these, and you could like, you see them along the wall, and they're all different colors and all kinds of different hilts and stuff like that. So I'm thinking that that's what these are going to be. They're going to be sort of like that quality, and they'll do a cool show.
Cool.
So yeah. I've seen photos across the web of the cast member uniforms, and yeah. You know, and that they look like they're in the First Order and stuff. But I'm looking at this photo at the Blackspire Outpost Fashion Shop. Is this like something?
Like this, so looks like the guests are going to have uniforms.
Yeah, did you buy this and can wear it around?
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, there's like legit like Halloween costumes for sale. Yeah, there. They're like amazingly detailed.
I wonder if they're going to go the full Wizarding World of Harry Potter and just with encourage the guests to wear costumes.
Yes.
Yeah, even though that's cool.
They're absolutely not. Not supposed to, according to current rules.
That's one of the things that blew me away.
People carry their bags of ice every time I go. So,
Chris, when we went, there were a lot of people who were dressed up, right? Or was that another time I went? But I remember going to Harry Potter one time, and there were tons of people dressed up, just wearing those robes.
I mean, when you and I went, there were like
every full-blown Hogwarts costume every time I go to Universal.
Everyone around us was wearing their robes. Every single person. We felt awkward being the only people not wearing.
Yeah, but I loved it. I thought that was so neat.
Yeah, it was fun. It was a good time, and guests didn't get them confused with employees, which was nice.
Yeah. So. But these look like, you're right, these are legit. They have First Order costumes. They have Jedi costumes. Then they have, you know, your shirts with Rey on it. Now, I've heard stories that they're not going to have anything in there that says Galaxy's Edge or Disneyland or anything like that, because you're supposed to be on Batuu. You're supposed to be in this world.
And then you see this T-shirt.
With a picture of Rey on it.
Rise of the Resistance.
Yeah.
There's a picture of Rey on it that says Rise of the Resistance, which is the name of the ride that's not opening. So.
Right, with Rey.
Well, it's probably because...
but these are cool, like, futuristic... There'll
be a T-shirt shop. There'll be a T-shirt cart outside of Galaxy's Edge as you walk out selling everything that they want you to sell. I'm sure they're going to have T-shirts that say Galaxy's Edge outside of Galaxy's Edge. That's probably where they're selling, you know?
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, I think that's all we got.
I think this is just the beginning. I think there's going to be some surprises here. I think there's a lot here already.
Yeah.
You know?
Tons of stuff.
And then we haven't even talked about the possible creatures that we'll be walking around and we'll be running into and seeing.
Yeah, they're supposed to have all kinds of people dressed up for guest interactions just around the land.
So it's not only just stormtroopers, but...
super cool.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And like I heard stories like if you buy merchandise or you go to Uga's Cantina and you get a drink or something like that, I don't know how it's going to work, but supposedly, like, if you were on the Millennium Falcon ride and you weren't a very good pilot or you crashed or you did something wrong, like, you get a reputation. And the workers know.
They'll charge you more.
Charge you more. They'll just say something like, oh, I heard about you. You know, like, you know, you had a rough time. Or they'll say, you did it. Congratulations. Your story's all over the Reddit of Star Wars or something.
The Reddit.
It's all over Twitter.
Yeah, Twitter.
The Emperor's tweeting about it.
Star Wars Twitter.
Sad.
Low IQ.
Oh, man.
Snapchat.
But yeah, they're supposed to do stuff like that. Like, I guess it's attached
to... Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Can you imagine? They'll probably create a separate app for it or something like that, where you'll have to download this app and there'll be some kind of interaction within that app.
That's right. There is actually an app component to this.
There's probably a special app that they'll have where all that stuff will happen in there, and then they'll say, oh, listen, so-and-so was this happened to so and so, and all of a sudden you see just see your like I said, your face is being, I don't know, on social media, Star Wars socials, on Batuu's social media, Batuu's blog. There you go.
The Batuu blog.
The Batuu.
The Batuu Parks blog.
Yeah, Batuu Parks blog. There you go.
Written by the Batuu moms. All right, everybody. I think that's going to do it for this episode. Thank you so much for listening. We really appreciate it. Show notes for this episode are at disgeek.com/152. Definitely go to the website because we have everything that we were just talking about. All the pictures are there. So you could see it for yourself. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. We're on Instagram. I spend the majority of my time at Instagram. I am at DisGeek Podcast. Tommy, where can everyone find you?
You can find me on the DisGeek Podcast. You can also find me here at the Cruise Dudes Podcast and thecruisedudes.com. And all of social media, just search Cruise Dudes, you'll find us.
Very cool. Chris, as you type this.
Yeah. What?
What's your Twitter?
Check out the show notes. Check out the show notes and you'll see it.
There you go. Jess?
I'm at Jess Jones, 1976.
Very cool. Guys, love y'all. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See ya.
Bye. See here my dream, all the pirates down in Neverland. Never get the hook, they just get a hand. While the croc sings Superman, so we can take it. And there she goes, my heart. When you wake up